This is the grandest ever structure, defining power and beauty. An emperor's dedication in the memory of his beloved. An incredible accomplishment of its time. A story of skills and artistry beyond imagination. A splendid jewel of architecture, an iconic representation of a nation. A monument which for years has drawn incomparable admiration and has left even the world leaders gasping in awe. A grand mausoleum where every moment and every step inside is an unending journey into a narrative of this heavenly masterpiece, the Taj Mahal. Each day, thousands line up to get the perfect shot, summing up emotions, memories, and that perfect moment with Taj, inside, yet distant. But as we get near the main mausoleum, appreciating its environs and tactility, the story of this grand monument unfolds.
Taj Mahal ki ek sabse khas baat jo maine mehsoos ki ki jitna large hai wo usse zyada large mehsoos hota hai. Jab aap campus mein dakhil hote hain to puri tarah se wo Taj Mahal ka jo impact hai na wo aapko overwhelm kar leta hai.
I think the monument is a very layered one. It's an extremely layered one, has different layers of knowledge attached to it. It has very intense symbolism attached to it as well.
I find the monument, I mean, at the parameters of architecture, this is one of the finest monument given to us by the Mughals in India.
A far humbler and humane than the scale and complicated dimensions it exhibits. It's here the foundation or the idea of Taj Mahal's creation is answered. This splendid mausoleum was commissioned to be built by the fifth Mughal emperor Shah Jahan in the fond memory of his beloved wife Arjumand Banu Begum, who was better known as Mumtaz Mahal.
Their love started at when they were still very young. So, and if you believe the contemporary writer Qazvini says that he has never seen two persons loving each other so much even after marriage. So Kazwini writes about their love, and the way he describes it in his Badshah Nama is just crosses all the boundaries of love. And when you see Shah Jahan being very compassionate towards Dara and Jahanara, you find, you know, a very good husband, a very compassionate father, a very emotional person. At the same time, you find a person who's an expansionist, a person who is like imposing his authority, who is very firm when it comes to other kingdoms, imposing the Mughal authority, and the one who is very proud of his Timurid legacy.
Strictly speaking, tombs are not supposed to be that much ornate or that developed, you know. If you look at the tomb of Babur, you know, or Aurangzeb, you know, these are very austere tombs. They are supposed to be very austere structures located in open air, you know, right? But the whole idea of infusing monumentalism to tomb and raising it to a level, you know, which is unsurpassed in the architectural terms, it's the first departure. The second departure, of course, is in terms of a tomb being dedicated to a woman, you know. Taj does not have a precedent of that kind in the Mughal dynasty, for sure.
An inseparable companion of the emperor, Mumtaz died in 1631 while giving birth to her 14th child. Broken by her death, Shah Jahan, who took Mughal Empire to its military and creative zenith, even surpassing his grandfather Akbar's feat, decided to build an edifice that would reflect a paradisical abode in heaven.
Very few people know that she's not only given, you know, heir to Mughal Empire, but she was also a very good economist. She has ships in her name. She was involved in trading, and wherever Shah Jahan is going, she's not afraid of the hardships of whether of Deccan Plateau or of Rajasthan or going to Balkh and Badakhshan. We find that she has always accompanied along with her kids to Shah Jahan. And when Shah Jahan is rebelling against his father, she's still there with Shah Jahan, and then her kids have been taken as a captivity, like Aurangzeb and Dara, by Jahangir, and they have been brought to the court. But she doesn't leave Shah Jahan. She is actually, she's the strength of Shah Jahan. And she's also a source of inspiration for him. At the same time, we find that she's involved in economic activities. So she's not just a woman within the walls of harem. She has her own individuality.
The fact is also most of the Taj years, construction years, are counted by Mumtaz's urs. So second anniversary, the podium is ready. 12th anniversary, the structure and the flanking monuments are ready. So Mumtaz continues to, you know, inform the construction of Taj Mahal and also influence the construction of Taj Mahal in several different ways. And finally, she is, for the third and final time, she is buried in the crypt in the mausoleum.
According to court chronicles, Shah Jahan, who was also buried next to Mumtaz in Taj Mahal, had promised his wife that he would not let the world forget her. Before being laid inside the sanctum of Taj Mahal, Mumtaz was buried in the gardens of Zainababad across River Tapti in Burhanpur, a Mughal outpost in Malwa region during Shah Jahan's reign.
Shah Jahan was so grief-stricken. And Kazwini writes that earlier, Emperor Shah Jahan had just 12 white hair in his beard. But when he came out after the mourning, this is no hyperbole, and he's writing it. When he came out of came out after mourning, all his hair and beard turned white, and he wouldn't stop crying.
It's also recorded that on midnight every Friday, Shah Jahan visited Mumtaz Mahal's temporary burial site and recited verses from Holy Quran. As much as the story of its grand layout and the architecture, this wonder of the world is also a story of the Emperor Shah Jahan himself.
He's one of the ablest generals that we find during the time of Jahangir. And Jahangir knew the capabilities of his son very well. And that is why when Shah Jahan is coming, like that Khurram, when he's coming from Deccan in the Mandu fort, he was given the title of Shah Jahan by Jahangir himself. And then the Mansab of Shah Jahan is raised to 30,000 and 20,000, right? So, so he is one of the ablest general, and he is one of the finest architects that we have. During his time, the paintings, especially the architecture, reached to its zenith.
I think, you know, Shah Jahan's career, you see, marks a very distinct watershed in terms of the Mughal rule in India. So whether it is the court cultures or whether it is the enhanced role of the ruler, which is, you know, done by several things, by court etiquettes or by the peacock throne, or by the way you address the emperor, or by the way you greet the emperor, the triple taslim, for instance, you know, basically. So Shah Jahan's reign is very different when in that sense. So that was one part of it, which is where you see an enhanced role for the emperor and very elegant court etiquettes, you know.
At the peak of his political power, commanding nearly 24% of world's GDP, Shahabuddin Muhammad Khurram, better known by his regnal name Shah Jahan, had commissioned the expansion and buildings of several magnificent palaces, forts, and even citadels. While the existing forts of Agra and Lahore were expanded during his time, the city of Shah Jahanabad and magnificent Red Fort at the modern national capital, Delhi, was established by the fifth Mughal emperor. But of all those grand structures, signifying vast political supremacy and the extent of an empire, it is this mausoleum envisioned and accomplished by a grief-stricken emperor, which has lived on to be regarded as one of his best creation. One of the seven wonders of the world.
Shah Jahan ke dimaag mein tha ki hum kuch majestic create kare, aur unhone us waqt ke jo architect aap keh sakte hain jo designers the un logon ko kaha ki aap is pe kuch taiyar kijiye. Bahut sare logon ne apne apne concept unhe dikhaye aur jo unhe pasand aaya wo unhone okay kiya aur is tarah se Taj Mahal banaya gaya. Par aisa kuch nahi tha ki Taj Mahal accidentally ban gaya. वो कंप्लीट प्लानिंग के साथ वो तैयार किया गया और उसके एक एक पार्ट में वो प्लानिंग का हिस्सा दिखाई देता है. मेरी बात का मतलब ये है कि ऐसा नहीं कि कोई चीज़ मिनरेट बाद में खड़ी कर दी गई. अगर मिनरेट बाद में खड़ी गई होती तो फिर जो उसका प्लेटफॉर्म बनाया गया उसका शेप कुछ और हो सकता था. तो वो जो नीचे से एक स्टेप वाइज चलता हुआ ऊपर जा रहा है, वो पूरी प्लानिंग पहले हुई है, कंस्ट्रक्शन बाद में हुआ है.
After Akbar, he's perhaps one of the greatest builders in this. Akbar was the first, you know, all Mughal emperors have built something or other. But Akbar did it on a major way, and Shah Jahan was one of the greatest builders in terms of that. Now, there are certain, you know, ways in which Shah Jahan's reign is very different. So the whole idea of privileging of marble, so he starts demolishing, you know, structures in Agra Fort, in Lahore Fort. But Taj Mahal was certainly one of the most ambitious exercises. Because, you know, it was as much physical as it was metaphysical. So the whole idea of creating a paradise garden and executing it to perfection was one of those most dominant challenges. And that keeps Shah Jahan apart from other rulers, you know, basically.
If you see Abdul Hamid Lahori's Badshah Nama, or if you read Qazvini's Badshah Nama, they were both were court historians, you'll find that this is called Rauza-e-Munawwara, Elephant Tomb. So it is not referred as Taj Mahal. It is only in the 19th century, then all by the European travelers, that we find that it is referred as Taj Mahal, because it was dedicated to Mumtaz Mahal. So they had taken the abbreviation from there, probably Taj Mahal, because she was like crown lady of the harem. So it is probably taken from there, but 19th century and the European travelers, the Persian chroniclers of Shah Jahan's period, they do not mention it as a Taj Mahal. They mention it as Rauza-e-Munawwara. Rauza means tomb, Munawwara means element. So it's like glowing tomb of the time.
The foundation of Rauza-e-Munawwara, meaning a unique building in Persian,
A very name by which Taj Mahal is referred to in Mughal chronicles was laid in January 1632. While the principal tomb complex along with its elaborate gardens were completed around 1647, Darwaza-e-Roza, the great gate which forms the main entrance, was complete around 1654. Today, thousands walk through inside this huge gate every day.
So as soon as you enter from the great gate, you know, and so it looks, you know, small and distant, but this the moment you start approaching it, you know, it expands and starts looking bigger, and as you come closer to the monument, you know, the certain things or certain features of the monument start becoming more dominant and more visible. So in a way, the monument also controls what you see from a certain point or certain distance from it, you know, basically.
ताज महल की एक सबसे खास बात जो मैंने महसूस की कि जितना लार्ज है वो उससे ज़्यादा लार्ज महसूस होता है। जब आप कैंपस में दाखिल होते हैं तो पूरी तरह से वो ताजमहल का जो इम्पैक्ट है ना, वो आपको ओवरवेलम कर लेता है। आप एकदम, जिसे उर्दू में कहते हैं, मरगूब हो जाते हैं उसके, मतलब क्या उसके लिए मैं वर्ड ढूंढने की कोशिश कर रहा हूँ हिंदी या उर्दू में, प्रभावित हो जाते हैं इस तरह से कि फिर आपके बदन में एक सिहरन सी दौड़ जाती है, और जैसे जैसे आप आगे बढ़ते जाते हैं और वो लगता है कि ये और बड़ा होता जा रहा है। मैंने तो इस तरह से महसूस किया। बाकी उसके हर हिस्से में खूबी है।
जिलू खाना प्रोवाइड्स द मेन एंट्रेंस और द नॉर्दर्न गेटवे टू द टूम। नाउ दिस गेटवे प्रोजेक्ट्स फर्स्ट, यू नो, इट्स लाइक बगदादी ऑक्टागन kind and assimilated with Akbari architecture, and this is here you find the finest calligraphic piece. If you look at the Arabic verses or the Quranic verses or the Arabic letters, this has been drafted by calligrapher Amanat Khan. From top to bottom, the sides are same. You will not find a single variation, and it is here on this gate that you find a calligrapher is signing. Rest anywhere, any other building of the Mughal Empire, this is the only building that on that gate where you find Amanat Khan is signing.
Given Shah Jahan's penchant for meticulous details and ornate symbolism, this particular spot to build Taj Mahal was chosen next to a beautiful bend of the river Yamuna. After careful reconnaissance, this particular spot at Agra was narrowed down. As per court chronicles, the land for Roza-e-Munawwara was acquired from Raja Jai Singh, one of Shah Jahan's Rajput general. In exchange, Raja Jai Singh was given four havelis in Akbarabad. The name Agra was referred to during those times.
So mausoleum, when you build, only when you know that the person is going to die or I'll die. So Shah Jahan did not even want to think about her death. So it was only after her death that, you know, 1632, that Taj Mahal was commenced, land was purchased from Raja Jai Singh, and he decided to build Taj Mahal or Roza-e-Munawwara for his beloved wife.
31 she dies, you know, 1631 she dies. Beginning of 1632, she's sent with the team, which is led by Shah Jahan's son, Shah Suja, along with the host of people who would be reciting prayers for her. And then there is also an exercise to find. So the importance being attached is what I'm trying to say. The whole, you know, effort being spent on looking at a suitable place. Now this kind of thing has never gone into the past, you know. Particularly for a woman. So the kind of effort, so they are finally able to locate a place, and a very unique place, you know, where Yamuna takes a sharp turn eastwards. And then, you know, there's a transaction with Jai Singh, you know, who is given four mansions in Akbarabad, you know, or Agra, as a part of, you know, so that he didn't want to have any disputes over that piece of land. And then, you know, she's buried there in what is now known as the second time in the southeastern corner of the mosque that is flanking the tomb, you know, basically.
From the very beginning, the idea was to have a distinct building, a something like never before structure. Shah Jahan, the great Mughal, was building a masterpiece for ages to come. While the court historians credited the emperor as the man behind design and the layout of Taj Mahal, the officers who commanded artists and workmen remain elusive or at best anonymous for a considerable time. But some later records mention the name of Ustad Ahmed Lahori as its chief architect.
As far as individual architects are concerned, you know, there is a complication. And the complication is that they were not supposed to leave their names there. Like painters would have their names in their paintings. But the only person who gets his name on the Taj is somebody with the title Amanat Khan, who is the calligrapher. And which is because the art of writing was seen to be a very esteemed art in the Islamic world. But then the names of these architects that you mentioned, you know, basically, feature in some other connection. And there are three names which become very important. One is, you know, Ustad Ahmed Lahori, who had come from Lahore. And it is his son who credits him with the building of Taj. You know, he comes alive in his son's account.
If you see, you know, the architects who have taken project, we do not have mention a name of those architects in any of the Persian chronicler, but there is one book by Lutfullah Mohandis, and he says that my father, he was an architect of Taj, and his father's name was Ustad Ahmed, and Ustad Ahmed is the one who made Red Fort in Shah Jahanabad. And then we find that Lutfullah Mohandis' son, Rizqullah, is making Bibi Ka Maqbara for Aurangzeb.
Ustad Lahori, a creative genius, was undoubtedly Emperor's favorite architect, as he, along with his architect companion, Ustad Hamid, were entrusted with the task of constructing Delhi Red Fort and, along with it, the beautiful city of Shah Jahanabad. Other names which figures in the records are of Mir Abdul Karim, Maulana Murshid of Shiraz, and Makarmat Khan. Makarmat Khan had famously replicated Peshawar's covered market, Chhatta Bazaar at Delhi Red Fort, which is today loosely referred to as Meena Bazaar of Lal Killa.
The second one is Mir Abdul Karim, you know, who was one of those favorite architects of Jahangir. He is mentioned in connection with the as a supervisor of the monument, along with an administrator called Makramat Khan. Now, Makramat Khan is also involved later, you know, in the construction of the Red Fort. Now, he is one of the many people who had come from Iran as the Mughal rule was coming more under Iranian influence, particularly in terms of arts, crafts, architecture, music, painting.
Actually, 13 saal Humayun exile mein raha. हिस्ट्री में आपको मालूम होगा, और एक्साइल में वो ईरान में. ईरान का जो आर्किटेक्चर है वो बड़ा रिच था. वहाँ पर इस्फहान एक शहर है जहाँ दैट इज़ कॉल्ड सिटी ऑफ 200 मॉस्क, और उसके बहुत सारे शहर जहाँ पर के डिफरेंट, मतलब ईरानियंस वो थोड़ा क्रिएटिविटी में बड़े अच्छे थे उस वक्त, और हुमायूं वहाँ से इंस्पायर होके आए थे इंडिया. हालांकि उनका पीरियड बहुत ज़्यादा उसके पास चल नहीं पाया, क्योंकि स्ट्रगल ही स्ट्रगल रहा लाइफ में. लेकिन वो जो इंस्पिरेशन उनका था, वो परहैप्स उन्होंने अपने बेटों में और सब में जो है वो कहीं ना कहीं शामिल कर दिया था.
मकरमत खान रिप्रेजेंटेड द इरानियन इन्फ्लुएंस दैट यू सी इन सच अ डोमिनेंट वे इन द ताज महल, एंड ही गोज ऑन टू बिकम एन इम्पॉर्टेंट पर्सन एज यू सी दैट यू नो ही इज सीन इन वन ऑफ द पेंटिंग्स यू नो वेयर इन कनेक्शन विद द मैरिज ऑफ दारा शिकोह. सो ही फीचर्स इन वन ऑफ द पेंटिंग्स. And he is also given a higher mansab when he constructs the city of Shah Jahanabad and a khilat by the emperor as well.
Known for its immeasurable beauty, Taj appears nestled inside an arch of the Great Gate. As we get through the gate, Taj enhances in scale, twice as great than put together. The multiplicity of its beauty is further enhanced with perfect symmetry, balance of form and space, the careful chosen hierarchy of materials, and a human story. The designing was carried out with accurate calculations of visual aesthetics, enforcing strict bilateral symmetry. Everything at Taj Mahal is just perfect in formalism, captivating even further with its grandeur and utmost finesse of artistry.
Taj does have a structural unity, but we tend to see it in bits and pieces. And I could see three or four elements to this whole idea of structural unity. One was this very general notion about symmetry and, you know, repetition of certain features to basically enhance the symmetry and to enhance the centrality of the structure. Be the framing, you know, whether it is the minarets or the two structures on the side, or the garden or the walls, or the forecourt, Jalaukhana, so, or the Tajgan. So the framing becomes very important. There's a hierarchy in design and motifs as well. And, you know, the last one, but not the least one, is the great attention to detail. So how the detailing of each of the structures makes up the larger whole.
The complex is also a continuation of tradition of erecting a tomb to honor the departed Mughal emperor, a practice which began with Gur-e-Mir, the tomb of Amir Timur at Samarkand, the progenitor of Timurid Mughal dynasty.
So Taj Mahal, basically, jo conceive kiya gaya Taj Mahal, aaj ki tarikh mein jo hum dekh rahe hain, wo aaya tha Taimur Lung ke maqbare se, jise Gur-e-Amir kehte hain. एक चपते टर्किक लैंग्वेज का वर्ड है जिसका मतलब होता है किंग ऑफ द वर्ल्ड. गुर-ए-आमिर में पहली बार एक ओवरवेलमिंग डोम दिखाई दिया जो पूरी इमारत के ऊपर हावी हो रहा था, जिसका फिर हम रिक्रिएशन हुमायूं टूम में देख सकते हैं. और फिर वहाँ से वो ताजमहल में गया. तो इन जनरल लोग कहते हैं कि वह जो है इंस्पायर्ड है हुमायूं टूम से, जो फैक्ट है, लेकिन हुमायूं टूम जो है वो इंस्पायर है गुर-ए-आमिर से.
A closer look at the great monument will acquaint us with several elements from earlier mausolea, infusing Islamic, Turkic, Persian and Rajputana styles.
So we find a very perfect kind of architecture, but at the same time we find he's not doing anything new. What he is doing, he is just experimenting with the existing traditions. So existing traditions like Chaharbagh is there. The tradition of building mausoleum at the center of Chaharbagh is there. But here in Taj Mahal, we find him little experimenting with it. Mausoleum is not at the center. It shifted to northern side. Then we find that Shah Jahan is also introducing Chahar Taq. Now, Chahar Taq is a cruciform form where you find that the main entrance, that is the southern gate, and the main tomb is on one axis, while the side axis or the cross axis and the traverse line, it forms a crucified form, which we find that he has taken it from temple architecture. Like if you see the Chalukyan temple, late Chalukyan, if you see the Kakatiya's temple, you'll find that crucified form. You'll find the same thing in Mathura Govind Dev temple, the same crucified form. So he's into Chaharbagh is already existing, but he is bringing Chahar Taq. And then we find that he is also bringing certain Buddhist architectural features. So like this is already existing, but he is just assimilating it in his style. In his architecture, which became a peculiar Shahjahani feature.
His columns, his balticas, arches, the use of marbles, there are certain things which set his apart. Also the fact that he used to have very regular meetings with the artisans and architects of his reign, basically. And later he goes on to find another very ambitious project, which is the whole the 17th century Mughal capital of Shahjahanabad, which in itself was another very big project, you know, basically, where he moves out of Agra and comes back and lays the foundations of a capital city in Delhi.
The first and foremost structure that comes to mind is of Humayun's tomb, the resting place of second Mughal emperor Nasiruddin Muhammad Humayun, Shah Jahan's great-grandfather, designed by Biraq Mirza Ghiyas. The large plinth and the placement of mausoleum are a common feature, though the scale of mausoleum differs with the broad-framed Humayun's tomb. The concept of Hash Bahisht, literally meaning eight heavens, a floor plan consisting of a central hall surrounded by eight rooms, is also a common feature between two monuments constructed nearly 70 years apart.
You know, the Hash Bahisht plans was achieved by converting a rectangular or a square shape into an irregular octagon. They would call it Baghdadi octagon by means of chamfered corners, right? So, you know, and if you draw four intersecting lines, then it also is known as the ninefold plan, which was done by constructing four intersecting lines in this irregular octagon.
Inspiration ki baat ye hai ki aapko jo impact dikh raha hai, jaise Humayun's tomb mein red sandstone ka istemal largely kiya gaya, aur white marble usme decorative element ke taur pe istemal kiya gaya tha, jahan kahin inlay kiya gaya तो वहाँ वाइट लाइन दी गई, वाइट से कुछ कैलीग्राफी या कुछ भी जो पैचिंग की गई वो वाइट स्टोन था। उसके बाद अगला स्टेप आया जहाँ पर के वाइट स्टोन को पूरी तरह से एडॉप्ट कर लिया गया बेस के तौर पे, और रेड स्टोन जो है वो पीछे चला गया। वहाँ पर फिर डेकोरेशन के लिए उन्होंने ब्लैक स्टोन इस्तेमाल किया।
Another great addition at Taj Mahal was the minarets, which could be seen at Akbar's tomb in Sikandra, a significant building of Mughal architecture, which was constructed by Shah Jahan's father, Jahangir.
If you look at the minaret, this is the Shah Jahan's buildings are the buildings where the tapering minarets are appearing on the building. Even the mosque, the minarets are appearing on the mosque. So here you find the slender and the tapering minarets. But the construction of minarets is that even if earthquake comes, it will not fall on the mausoleum, it will fall outside, so it will not damage the building. That is what I find something very unusual about the building, right? So there is a provision for fighting against the flood, earthquake, and also there is a, you know, added beautification to the building. Monumentality is there.
Among the most poignant features of Taj Mahal's architecture remains its dome. A huge double dome atop with a finial raised on a drum, a style that first appeared in Humayun's tomb. A perfect onion-shaped double dome seen through several Mughal monuments and tombs, starting Gur-e-Mir. It's also this dome and the finesse of its creation which accords Taj the status of perfection in architecture. Complementing the dome are these four column supported canopy pavilions atop with domes. These chhatris are also symbolic of major influence of Rajput styled architecture, an element of Indian building art which is largely used in temples. These elements also make Taj Mahal a journey of perfection, where those evolving styles reached a completion like never before.
There is a journey, you know, basically. There's a journey being traveled here. And how, in terms of evolution of the tomb itself. So the first one, in terms of, when you look at the first set of tombs, which is Iltutmish's tomb in Qutb Minar, you know, you're looking at square tombs, you know, basically square tombs, and the dome has still not reached a perfect stage, right? From there, if you move on, you look at the Lodhi tombs, and there you have, in order to get a perfect dome, they're also getting into an octagonal shape, you know. So the Lodhi tombs are getting into octagonal shapes, you know, and then they use, you know, as in the case of Iltutmish tomb, you know, pendentives and squinches to, you know, give a firm base to the dome. But in the earlier times, the Delhi Sultanate time, they still have not been able to get the formula right for the dome, so that it doesn't remain stable. It's stable very much in Alai Minar, but it's not stable there. The idea of a dome, a bigger dome, which is resting on a big drum, to give it elevation. So the big dome also comes into being, in terms of true dome. The first true dome, double layered, true dome comes into being in a big way in Huayi's tomb itself.
There was an entire department of architecture, so building activities were taken by that department. There was a Daroga Mimara. There was also a chief architect, Ustad, or Mimar. There was also Mohandis, who were engineers or mathematicians. They had to know mathematics. They were very well versed with the type of material they were using. They were giving time for the completion of their project. So there was a supervisor. There was also Najjars, the carpenters. There were also Nakasha Navis, like those who were making drawings. And Abdul Hamid Lahori, when he's writing about the dimensions of Taj Mahal, had he been not having those drafts, had he not been having those maps, he would not have given such accurate dimensions of Taj. So, and we had the reference coming from Abdul Hamid Lahori that first the wooden, the model was made. And that model was presented in front of Shahjahan.
But what makes Taj Mahal so distinct is also a careful hierarchical choice of placing materials by its creator. The hierarchy of materials comes into play as soon as one steps inside the complex. The monochrome red tiles on the floor gets busier in theme and design as they go beyond the Great Gate to Chaharbagh, the ornate garden, and finally to the central axis housing the mausoleum. The central axis courtyard, which begins with simply laid red colored floor on the flanks, gradually gets ornate with marble inlay as we reach Chameli Farsh, the peripheral floor along the plinth. It's also the last installment of any red colored portion in the complex.
Marble ko ek bada jise hum kehte hain na bada sacred pavitra patthar mana jata tha aur jo sufi wagaira the unki maqbaron mein uska istemal hota tha 100% ya koi bahut luxury decorative jagah hai jahan par ke wahan par aap interior mein istemal karte the usko exterior mein is large scale pe nahi istemal kiya jata tha. बट ताजमहल में वो फिर एक्सपेरिमेंट हुमायूं टूम से निकला, फिर वो एतमादुद्दौला में आकर के वो पूरी तरह से एडॉप्ट कर लिया गया. फिर ताजमहल वो अपने एकदम पीक पर है जहाँ पर के जो मुग़ल आर्किटेक्चर है उसका जितना भी एक्सपेरिमेंट जहाँ जहाँ किया गया वो सब ला करके यहाँ पर एकदम उसका बेस्ट लेके ताजमहल बनाया गया.
व्हेन यू लुक एट द मटेरियल ऑर्नामेंटेशन or the detailing of the architectural features, there is a certain move towards sophistication once you move further inwards towards the tomb, right? So from outer side, once you are approaching the tomb, in terms of these three features, there is certain movement towards sophistication. They are becoming more ornate, more exquisite as you move towards that. So that broadly reflects the principle of hierarchy. But at no point of time, the focus on the centrality of the tomb is compromised.
While the mausoleum, its minaret and plinth are made of white marble, the peripheral structures are in red sandstone. Color separation is extremely important here, granting Taj a never-before-exalted status among the league of earlier tombs. Even two major edifices at central axis, the mosque at the western flank and its mirror image structure on the eastern side called Mehman Khana, a resting house, are constructed with red sandstone. The only exception happens to be intricate marble floral patterns on the grand central gates of those two structures and their domes, which are covered with white marble.
If you see the Mehman Khana, the Western Mosque, the octagonal bastions on the transverse axis, you find it's a perfect crucified form. So this is somewhere I find that he is experimenting with the building, and then he is making it different. And then here the entire mausoleum is made of white marble in contrast with the red. And the moment when you enter, you know, the gateway, it hides Taj Mahal. The moment you cross that, then only you can see the, you know, entire Taj Mahal.
As opposed to the flanking structures, you know, by way of Mehman Khana or the mosque, you know, which are in more in red sandstone, and only the prized parts of it. So basically some ornamentation in the spandrels or the dome or parts of the prized parts are in marble, right? But otherwise they are mostly in red sandstone. Now, there's a very interesting interaction between red sandstone and white marble that goes on and that reaches its culmination in the Taj. Ever since the establishment of Delhi Sultanate, this whole thing had the dynamic between red sandstone and white marble had come into being.
The massive arched facade is inlaid with white marble and black stones. And a raised vast courtyard is set with elements which accentuates the collective beauty of Taj Mahal, prominent being these water fountains. The rich red sandstone was extensively used by Mughals in Humayun's tomb, red forts at Agra and Delhi, Fatehpur Sikri, Akbar's tomb at Sikandra and Jam Masjid. The construction scale of the main mausoleum, though immensely elaborate, is fairly linear. The principal construction of Taj is of Lakhori bricks, the red burned bricks, narrower in width. It is then covered with Sangemarmar, the famous white marble of Makrana mines. One of the principal reasons to source marble from this mine was its peculiar trait of being robust yet soft enough to allow intricate carvings and pietradura. Pietradura, the technique of inlaying marbles with precious and semi-precious stones, was first developed in Italy during 16th century, essentially in the buildings of Florence. But here at Taj, the art is said to have reached its peak in improvisation, with marble inlaid with Islamic motifs of flowers, floral arabesques, vases and pots, which was first seen in the tomb of Itmat-ud-Dawla.
So some of the historians, including Abakok, have suggested that, you know, the role of European lapidaries in the introduction of Pietradura in the court of the Mughals. And normally, you know, some of them even trace the role of Austin de Bordeaux, the French lapidary who was in the Jahangir's court, you know, he's being credited with the introduction of this art, you know, basically. But then there is a counter side to it as well, which is, you know, some historians, you know, have, you know, criticized it on two grounds. One is that, you know, the Florentine Pietradura was principally figurative, right? So there are living beings there, right? As opposed to the Islamic Pietradura seen in the context of Taj Mahal, which is more, you know, floral.
Some scholars also equate the art with larger indigenous tradition of Panchankari, the form in which inlay was done on metals. But it would not be wrong to admit that in terms of complexity, subtlety and elegance, Mughal Pietradura work surpasses that of any Italian artist. Even today, Agra is known for its subtle marble wares and artifacts. Manufactured in a suburban settlement around the Taj complex called Taj Ganj. But it's not just Pietradura, the very mausoleum is designed with identical frames on its four sides. Each side of the facade is parted in three frames with a huge grand recess in the middle and two identical screens on the side, which are divided in two stories. The two arch-shaped cut-through marble screens at the Jali provides light and airflow to the inner chambers, and screen is further divided into several blocks. The outer walls, all four facades are studded with decorated inlay of calligraphy, the verses from Holy Quran, explaining the meaning of this garden of paradise.
Calligraphy worldwide Islamic architecture का एक बड़ा अहम हिस्सा रहा, क्योंकि इस्लाम में लिमिटेशन थी, आपको डेकोरेशन के लिए या तो आप फिगरेटिव आर्ट में नहीं जा सकते, आइदर इट वुड बी वेजिटेटिव और वो फूल पत्ती, या फिर आप कुछ ज्योमेट्रिकल पे आए। और उन्होंने एक बड़ा 100% जो एडॉप्शन था वो इस कैलीग्राफी का, कुरान की आयतें लीं और उसको बड़े आर्टिस्टिक तरीके से लिखा और उसको इनले कर दिया, ये जो भी मीडियम से उन्होंने डिस्प्ले किया। यहाँ तक कि तुर्की, ईरान, यहाँ पर तो कैलीग्राफी की बहुत सारी स्टाइल इस्टेब्लिश हुई जिनका अलग अलग नाम दिया गया। ताजमहल में वो स्पेशली नस्तालीक कहलाती है।
Whether you see it in the Great Gate, the same kind of ideas are being replicated in the Pishtak, right? The Pishtak or the semi-Pishtaks, which are in the Great Gate, they are same kind of ideas, but at each stage with a value addition. They are being replicated in the two flanking structures, the Mehman Khana and with a bit of difference, and mosque with a bit of difference, and then when it comes to the tomb itself, with a bit of difference, but at each stage there is a value addition itself. So in terms of individual architectural features, even if you see in terms of compare it with dados, the dados as they are found in the two flanking structures, and the dados in Taj Istifal are qualitatively superior, and the monument itself are qualitatively superior. Likewise in the columns as well, the columns become more ornate, more intricate as you Shahjahani columns as you move inside the structure.
But what makes Taj a complete architectural masterpiece are these four identical minarets. Adding to the scale and grandeur, these minarets also make Taj an exquisite tomb. For long, these minarets have been subject of study as well. To provide maximum life to the mausoleum, each minaret was erected in a way that it slants extremely minutely towards the outer side. The reason, in case of any natural disaster, the minarets would tend to fall far away from the tomb. And finally, the tangible journey at Taj reaches full circle inside the central chamber of the tomb. A place where the cenotaphs of Mumtaz and Shahjahan are situated, surrounded by a marble screen. Following a long tradition of burying the actual mortal remains in the lower chamber, which are restricted in the access. Following the Hush Behesht floor plan, the chamber is octagonal hall with a high and vaulted ceilings. Each facade is designed with two arches, the bottom arch of two sides, north and south opening for entrance, and two other on the west and east, set with screens to provide light in the chamber. Just like the exterior screens, the walls of the inner chamber too are decorated with inscriptions of arabesque calligraphy, floral motifs and cusped arch inlays. Artistry is on a never-ending scale here.
Shahjahan loved showing his wealth, and that is depicted in his building. So costliest of precious stones and material has been used on his building. So we find that was built by Bibadal Khan, his famous goldsmith, the one who built Peacock Throne. He's building that gold railing. And later on, Shahjahan thought that people might attack Taj Mahal. They will loot it just because he's adding a lot of gold here, because it has already been done in done elsewhere. So he didn't want that. So he replaced it with the marble railing. And there you find hibiscus, lotus, rose. It's a perfect Petra Diura, and there is one flower which has 36 capitals. That is the one of the finest piece of Petra Diura coming in architecture, and that is in Taj Mahal.
And just beside Mumtaz, lies the cenotaph of Shah Jahan. It is this asymmetrical placement of Shah Jahan's cenotaph, something which stands at odds with the Shahjahani style of formalism and strict symmetry, which for long has given a lie to the myth of Black Taj Mahal.
आपको किसी चीज का माकूल जवाब नहीं मिलता जब तक कि आप ब्लैक ताज में नहीं चले जाते, जहां सारे मॉन्यूमेंट हैं और पूरे मुगल आर्किटेक्चर की आप हिस्ट्री उठा के देखें, तो एंड पे जाके मॉन्यूमेंट बनाना और उसके आगे गार्डन छोड़ देना, ये एक सवाल पैदा करता है। दूसरा सवाल इसके बाद ये पैदा होता है कि ठीक इसके अलाइनमेंट में रिवर बैंक के अदर साइड एक पूरी साइट है, वहाँ भी आपको फोर क्वार्टर गार्डन के एक एलिमेंट्स दिख जाते हैं, उस वो क्यों है?
The idea of Black Taj Mahal was floated by Jean Baptiste Tavernier, a 17th century French gem merchant and traveler who visited Agra in 1665, well at the twilight of Shah Jahan's reign. In his passages, the traveler wrote that Shah Jahan wanted to build his own tomb in black marble on the other side of Yamuna in Mehtab Bagh, but his sons opposed the plan. As per Tavernier, Shah Jahan's third son and its successor, Aurangzeb, finally abandoned it. There is, however, no historical evidence to support his claim, and even archaeological excavations carried out in 1990s did not reveal any evidence of a tomb.
We do not find any reference in any of the Persian source, and Shah Jahan's last wish was to be buried next to Mumtaz Mahal, and his grave is next to Mumtaz Mahal. So I don't think he wanted a separate mausoleum or the Black Taj Mahal.
Black Taj Mahal is very much a part of popular history and a very much an integral part of the narratives by guides, basically. And that has become a core part of history which historians need to engage with, whether they agree with it or not, and then they could tell the story needs to be told and then perhaps dismiss it as well, basically. This generated so much interest that excavations were undertaken. Archaeological excavations were undertaken on the other side of the river, which is the left bank of the river, and what they found was a full-fledged charbagh, which is now known as the name, which was known as by the name of Mehtab Bagh.
सवाल ये है कि जिस वक्त वो मुमताज़ की कब्र बनाई गई और उसके बाद एक बहुत प्रॉपर मैनर में फ्लोर का बॉर्डर बना के पूरे फ्लोर को ज्योमेट्रिकल डिज़ाइन से फिल किया गया है, जिसे हश्त बहिश्त कहते हैं इस्लामिक, उसमें 8 पॉइंट स्टार भरा हुआ, शाहजहां की कब्र उस सारे डिज़ाइन के ऊपर सुपर इम्पोजिशन है। दैट इज़ द ओनली एसिमेट्री इन द ताजमहल। इसका जवाब किसी स्कॉलर के पास नहीं।
Dismissed by many and with no records to prove that Shah Jahan was indeed building a black replica of this wonder across the banks of Yamuna, the legend of Black Taj Mahal lives on. Disputed, contended, but a fascinating story nonetheless. But what is not disputed is the very concept of Garden of Paradise. The Grand Gate leads to the beautiful four-quartered garden or Chaharbagh. Traditional gardens divide into four parts through waterways. While the first conception could be seen at Babur's tomb, Bagh-e-Babur at Kabul, the layout was first used at Humayun's tomb in a monumental scale.
Chaharbagh, which is the Timurid Persian concept of a fourfold garden, and it is raised to the it gives you an architectural imagery of a paradise, which is basically set a garden which is set a walled garden with flowering trees, fruit bearing trees and flowing waters.
ये जो चार नहरों का सिलसिला था कि चार तरफ से आ रही है, एक सेंटर में पूल बनाया गया, इसका लिंक और ज़्यादा हो जाता है उसी जन्नत के कॉन्सेप्ट से। बाबर वॉज द ओरिजिनेटर ऑफ दिस कॉन्सेप्ट। बाबर बाघों का दीवाना था और उसने जहाँ भी बहुत सारे बाघ जो हैं वो एट्रिब्यूटेड हैं बाबर के नाम से इंडिया में, तो वो फोर क्वार्टर गार्डन, उसका कनेक्शन वही जन्नत से है। कि जहाँ पर जन्नत के चार हिस्से हैं और एक बीच में नहर आ रही है, चारों तरफ से आ रहा है, और फिर वो शाहजहाँ के टाइम पर आते आते तो एकदम रिफाइन हो करके अपने बेस्ट पर आया, उसको एकदम आर्किटेक्चर का पार्ट मान लिया गया। अगर आप ताजमहल से गार्डन निकाल देते हैं तो आप पाएंगे ताजमहल वीरान हो जाता है।
वन मोर थिंग दैट शाहजहाँ इज डूइंग, लाइक ही इज ब्रॉडनिंग द वाटरवेज एंड नैरोइंग द पाथवेज, सो हाईलाइटिंग दैट कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ कैनाल्स ऑफ पैराडाइज। एंड इफ यू लुक एट द वर्सेस ऑल्सो टॉक अबाउट द only one who believes will enter the paradise.
The Chahar Bagh forms one of the most important elements of Taj Mahal. The linear water canal starting below the plinth of the Grand Gate goes on till Marble Plinth, with Taj at the end of the gardens. The continuous canal is intersected by a beautiful square pool at the center of the garden, with a marble platform running along its perimeter. An extremely sophisticated concept of transition from the material world to that of a paradise. While the Taj itself and the Chahar Bagh are considered as heavenly objects, a huge courtyard before the Great Gate and the settlement behind East, South and West Gates are all said to belong to the world of materialism.
There is a transition zone, which is the Jilaukhana, where you have the Khwas Puras, where the tomb assistant would reside. And then there is a material zone, which is the Tajganj side. So along with the streets, bazaars, caravanserais, this reflected the material side of Taj and was a part of the original conceptualization of the Taj.
A section of bazaar and caravanserai complex at the southern end, and Tajganj, the colony of artists, existed soon after the building of Taj Mahal. This place was developed under imperial patronage with the intention of establishing a commercial center. In past, this place was one of the prominent markets to buy rare items from all over the world. Over the years, rapid urbanization has altered the matrix of settlement around the Taj. What possibly could have been a well-laid city space in earlier times has now morphed into a cluster and overgrown buildings, many of them still housing the descendants of the artists and workers who had built the Taj Mahal. In a sense, it is this great gate which acts as transition from material world to that of a paradise.
You will not find any monument which is better symmetrically in monumentality or in a in a beauty. So I find that and there's a complete contrast which is given. There's a green contrast of green bed, then there's a red sandstone, and then there's a white. So it's what we find, it's probably working on that Achaemenidian principle of like contrast colors present in the mausoleum.
It was supposed to be a replica of the house of Mumtaz Mahal, earthly replica of the house of Mumtaz Mahal in the Paradise Garden. And in the process of depicting that, it was also something which reflected the power and glory of the Mughals.
The journey is endless at Taj Mahal. From its crafting precision, the skills of workers and artisans, to the very conception of this wonder. An undying poetry carved on the stones. A building famously referred to as a drop of a tear from the heaven. A remarkable human achievement. Taj Mahal tells its story from every dimension.